Let's get started then. Let us take a moment to remind ourselves why we are here. Remind ourselves how it is we are here. And reflecting on that great opportunity, being grateful to all those who have paved the path for us to be here today. Right from your teachers, all the way to the greatest teacher mankind has ever seen. The greatest teacher is the one who does not have a teacher. That is how you find who the greatest teacher is. He doesn't have a teacher. He has to discover the path all by himself. You know how difficult and how arduous it is for us to navigate this path with a teacher. Just imagine how it must have been for someone without one. Nothing short of a miracle. That is why we call him the miraculous one. There's none like him. There's none who has traversed this path without another's help. Even those such as the great elder Sariputta, Mahamoggallan. They had a teacher. You know that the Sariputta Thera's wisdom was only second to the Buddha. You know this, right? And yet, he needed a teacher. Even he could not find the path for himself. He needed someone to guide him, at least by a mere word. E dhamma hetu pabhava. That must convince you that this truth cannot be discovered by oneself. Unless, of course, you are the supremely enlightened one. Now that you're listening to these sermons, you're listening to Guru Hamdru, you've been on this journey for a while, it's seeming like it's making sense. Yes. You're experiencing the freedom from desire, aversion and delusion. Yes. But thanks to whom? You know that this is the right path because you've got a guidebook. You know the yardstick with which to measure your success, your journey, the distance that you traverse on this path. But what did he have? Nothing. He had to do it and then check it out for himself. If he was wrong, there was no one there to tell him he was. In fact, many people did. Even when he was going the right path, people said, "What the heck are you doing? This is not what you should be doing," because no one knew. You know, we take the Buddha lightly sometimes. We say his name every day, day in, day out. We do the morning Buddha Puja, the afternoon Buddha Puja, the evening Gilampasa Puja. Buddha, 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 right? This is one of those words that flows through our minds and through our mouths so freely. But he's a very special gift. He's like no other. He's unique. That is why we call him the unparalleled one. That's why we call him the peerless one. There's no one we can look at and say, just like the Buddha, he also did this, or he also did that. No, can't say that. Not just like the Buddha. Now then consider how fortunate we all are. How close you have come to him. You have come to his embrace, to his feet. You have begun to drink the milk of the Dhamma that flows through his infinitely compassionate chest. How fortunate do you think you are? Almost all of you have even come into robes, or at least as close as you can to a robe. This is unheard of. The advent of a Buddha is so rare. And then to be able to hear his teaching, is even more. To want to come along every day and be on this path until you achieve your salvation, I think is probably the rarest thing ever. Well done. Because you have understood, you have realized the value of the Supremely Enlightened One. This is the greatest respect, the greatest reverence that you can make to one. Giving your life. You can give your material possessions. You can give some food. You can give some clothes, some medicines. You can give your house. You can give the whole world, but once you've given your life, what else remains? Offering your life is what we do. When we say Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhasa, I turn my life towards that path. I choose that course for my life. That is what we remind ourselves. That is the pledge that we take. Our lives have no other purpose than Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhasa. So, bearing that in mind, purposefully, let us bring our hands together, our palms together in veneration of the Magnificent One, the Glorious One, the Undefeated One, the Unvanquished One. He is like none other. There was only one like Him, and there will be no more like Him. He is our Father, He is our Guide, He is our Master, and to His holy name we make this veneration. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Just consider for a moment how much our lives have changed. Where were we meant to end up? And where are we now? You know, individually, just take a moment to think about this. No matter what your age is, male or female, just go back to the day that you first heard these talks, you heard that voice, you heard Guru Swami Nuhansa's voice, and you thought, wow, I've just discovered the purpose of my life. Again. Because that would have happened to you on previous occasions as well, but what you didn't know was this is the last time that you were going to say that story. I've discovered the purpose of my life. When you heard your math teacher at school, when you heard your physics teacher at school, when you heard someone get up on a stage, take a mic and start to speak to you, and they excited you emotionally, you thought, yep, I've discovered the purpose of my life. But then you said that one last time, maybe 3 weeks ago, maybe 6 months ago, for some of you maybe 6 years ago. And then from that day, your life took a very different turn, didn't it? One that seems incomparable to all that you have taken before that. The product of all those decisions you've made since that day is what sits in front of me right now. That is that product. Now take a moment to go back in time. Just imagine that that day never happened in your life. Where would you be today? Don't look down in embarrassment, as I'm doing. And or not, let's be honest. Where would you have been, madam? Where would you have been, sir? Do I need to begin to ask? Look at how many people have benefited from this encounter of a Buddha. You know, it's not just one person, two people, three people. Just look at all of us. The many scores of people who listen to these talks, but they're not able to come here just yet. But I know, even by now, many dozens of people living far across these oceans, they're making plans. They are. We're beginning to get news from them. Where is your monastery? Why do they bother asking if they're not planning on coming? How do I get there? If I come, can I stay? Will you keep me for 2 weeks, please? I'm not asking for much. If I bring my son, would you let me and him stay for 3 weeks? These are some of the questions that we are getting to hear. Those days we only heard that from the four corners of this land. But now, those cries for emancipation are coming from far and wide. I told you this tsunami was coming, and it is coming. Collectively, we have all made that change. I think if the Buddha were here today, he would be very proud of us. Don't you? I'm asking about you, not me. Let me sort that out with my Buddha. I'm asking about you. If the Buddha were here today, would he not be proud of you? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Whatever you have made, whatever change you have made, whatever contribution you have made, initially to your own selves. If you haven't helped yourself, you can't help anybody else. That is not the way this asana works. You can't. Anyone who has made any contribution to the sasana has made a contribution to themselves. Full stop. The extent to which you have managed to save yourselves, the degree to which you have managed to free yourselves from the pangs of suffering, from the clutches of desire, from that fog of delusion, the extent to which you have been able to save yourselves from that is the extent to which you have been able to pave the path for yet more people to come and get this, take this advantage. So we are hearing those cries from far and far afar now. Yesterday, someone told me that there's a gentleman who lives in a country called Cameroon. I don't know if many of you have heard that name. It's in the South African continent. He's a black gentleman. He listened to these sermons. Don't you think he would be proud? And not just that. He'd come to know that we do these merit transfers at the end of every almsgiving. And recently he'd sent a list of his relatives, past relatives, and said, please, at the next transfer of merits, can you read their names out and transfer merits to them? And I would like to make an offering to the Buddha Sasana. Just think about the change it has, you know, the Dhamma has had on people's lives. I was a non-believer. Yes, I called myself a Buddhist because that is what you were supposed to do. I was born to Buddhist parents. That is why I call myself a Buddhist. But not all of you were. Not all of you were born to Buddhist parents. Not everyone who's listening to these sermons now, week on week, were born to Buddhist parents. They are becoming Buddhist parents. But parents in a very different way. Biological parents, even animals can do that. But I'm talking about spiritual parents. I'm dead certain each and every one of you would have held someone else's hand and brought them here. Not literally here, but here, to his feet. Each and every one of you would have brought one other person. Were you not a parent then, when you did so? When you interested someone in just listening to a talk, you know, there's a philosophy. You've got to listen to that man. That philosophy is life-changing. So before you could say that, you had to prove to them that it is life-changing. So what you did was, you practiced the path, you listened to the sermons, you came along, you'd started doing your merits, and you just became a wonderful, beautiful, blessed person to be around. That is what you did first. That is why you are deserving of this praise. That transformation happened within you first. And so you could proclaim, you could look at others and go, see, I have changed. How do you recommend a good dentist to someone? You open your mouth and you begin to smile and half of your teeth are fallen. Huh? Can you now claim to know a good dentist? The other half is rotten. You can't claim to know a good dentist. But if when you smile, you have a beaming smile and it's beautiful to look at, a full set of teeth, white as white can be, now can't you claim to know a good dentist? Won't people believe you when you recommend one? Absolutely. So it is only someone who has good dental hygiene that can recommend a good dentist. So then tell me, who is someone who can recommend a good philosophy? Who has good spiritual hygiene? What is your spiritual hygiene? You understand what I'm talking about because you've all come that far. You've all come some way on this journey. Good spiritual hygiene. People can sense that. When you have good dental hygiene or poor dental hygiene, can't people sense that? Of course, you get a reaction. Some will say, can you smile again? I like that smile. Others will say, please can you ensure you don't smile again? So people know when you have good dental hygiene. In the same manner, ladies and gentlemen, people know when you have good spiritual hygiene. It is not how well you can speak the Dhamma, explain the Dhamma, that is not what good spiritual hygiene is. I always tell you this thing. How do we know the great elder Sariputta? Honestly, how do you know him? You know his name because it appears in the texts. But when you hear these words, the great elder Sariputta, that you feel like even uttering the word requires you to just at least slightly stand up from your seat. The great elder Sariputta. Let's be honest, none of us know how much Dhamma he knew, do we? If his wisdom was only second to the Buddha, how the heck are we ever going to know how much he knew, how profound his wisdom was? But we do know him. How do we know him? We know him by what others have said about him. That's how we know him. When you read his biography, when you read the biography of Bhadrakachayana, the great Theri, when you read the biography of Kisa Gotami, the great Theri, when you read the biography of Rahula, the great Thera, Anagarika Mahatmyas are doing a fantastic job bringing these stories to life for the modern era. Because in the 21st century, not many people have time to go and read these books because they have other books to read, like How to Get to the Moon in 3 days. You know, these are long-lost heroes. They were the people whose footsteps on this earth were a blessing to the earth. You know, today we must consider it our privilege to be able to walk on this earth, right? It's a privilege. We are honored, we feel privileged to be able to walk on this earth. But back then, the earth felt privileged to have those great men and women walk on it. Because every footstep they took, something wonderful happened. Hearts were healed. Desires were quenched. They were completely exterminated. Aversion and delusion had nowhere to run or hide. Mara's army had to go looking for places to hide. Every time in each of these Udana stories where the Buddha or his disciples speak about their encounters with the Mara, every single time, if they were a disciple of the Buddha, the Mara always failed. I mean, come on, what a legacy. If you watch a football match, you know, they have the scores on the board, right? So first it begins at 1-0. And then it goes 1-1. Then it goes 1-2. Then it goes 2-1. Yeah, that's how a football game goes. Now tell me the game of the Buddha's asana. On the one hand, you have the great arahants. You have the Buddha. On the other hand, you have Mara. Which match did we lose? Tell me. Which game did we lose? Our forefathers, our ancestors, those great men and women who showed us the path, who put down their footsteps in front of us so that we could follow in those footsteps, which game did they lose? To this day, the score stands. Whatever their score was. And on the other hand, for Mara, 0. Every name I relate to you, that's one. Ananda, one. Sariputta Thera, one. Rahula Thera, one. Mara, 0. Kashyapa Thera, one. Kisa Gotami Thera, one. Mara, 0. He should have learnt his lesson when he went and met our father. But he didn't. That's why he's called the Mara. Maybe that is his job. So why do his disciples today, the Mara's disciples, not realize that this is not a game that they can win? You know, one encounter with the Buddha is enough. You've all had that encounter, you know, proper encounter, a real encounter. Not just rubbing shoulders with them, but actually if a Buddha speaks, oh my God, it is the end. Is it not? It matters not what question you ask him. Imagine the Buddha came, he arrived to our Katnapingam today. Right? You want to just go and offer him a gilampasa. Or maybe, you know, someone just comes up and they're lost. They're asking for directions. And they bump into the Buddha. Venerable sir, I'm trying to go get to Ingiriya. Which way do I go? You're asking the wrong question, young man. Can you give me the time, please? You know, just bump into the Buddha. You're asking for the time. Right? You want to get to an appointment. You know, I mean, you think you're running late, so you want the time. Can I have the time, please? You're asking the wrong question, young lady. What is time? And then he begins. How fortunate must we be to have encountered the Buddha? Just think about it. Don't think of yourselves lightly. So much so that I think, you know, you can no longer be named Homo sapiens. I think they need another name at the end of that. Because once you encounter the Buddha, once you listen to his teaching, and if you have at least taken the first step on the journey to become an Aryan, you are no longer Homo sapiens. It's a different species altogether. Because you don't behave like Homo sapiens, do you? What do Homo sapiens do when they get attacked? Huh? They attack. Because it is called the survival of the fittest. But in the Buddha's asana, if you're an Aryan, that is not what you do. You don't attack. When someone hits you, you don't hit back. When someone bites you, you don't bite back. When someone scolds at you, shouts at you, either rightly or wrongly, you are like a sponge, you just absorb everything, a shock absorber. Because you can, that's why. You absorb because you can. You absorb because it doesn't hurt you anymore. You have taken a different perspective. It's not just out of patience. Yes, patience is a virtue, but there's an even greater virtue. It doesn't hurt. Harsh words don't hurt anymore. Do they? You know what I'm talking about. Harsh words don't hurt anymore. Accusations don't bother you anymore. Do they? You fool, you donkey. They don't hurt us anymore. You dog. You called, we respond in return. Don't hurt us anymore. The philosophy of not hurting. So we can always be more accommodating of those people who are hurt, because we don't hurt. So there's no eye for an eye. There's no tit for tat. We don't wage war. No battles to fight. This is really, you know, a transformation that is worth celebrating. And you need to. You need to because you deserve to. That is on one side, but what about the other side? You know, sensuality is a disease of the mind, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you've begun to realize that. Lust is a disease of the mind. It's a disease. It's an ailment. Normal minds don't feel that. It is not normal to feel lust. It is abnormal. It is not right. It's wrong. Not morally wrong. It's just wrong. It's like if it just started walking. That's wrong, right? That's wrong. Not morally wrong, it's just wrong. Lust is a disease of the mind. It's wrong. Desire is a disease of the mind. It's wrong. So the Dhamma heals. The Dhamma is the medicine. His teaching is the medicine. It heals. We know it heals. Because we are experiencing the extinguishing of that desire. That is why I can speak to you. And I can tell you, come on this journey. It is so blissful. It is not just the end that is blissful. Even the journey is blissful. Enjoy the breeze while you take the ride. Open your windows. Enjoy the breeze. It's so cool and soothing. Because desire is a disease. And aversion is a disease. Ego is a disease. Remind yourselves how much you suffered, and perhaps you still do, to whatever degree desire, aversion and delusion have still, you know, they still overtake your mind. If it hurts you, if it bothers you, right, you are diseased. You're ailed. Identify that, recognize that. And then work towards salvation. But many people don't do this because they don't realize this. They think desire is part of normalcy. And you know, this is why we often say, come to the sasana. Because only in the sasana will people respect you, regard you and recognize you. As for someone, if you don't feel desire here, they will say, hats off to you, sir. Hats off to you, madam. Kudos. But out there, if you say, I don't feel desire, they'll take you to the doctor. You don't agree? Try it at home. Try it at the workplace. Try it among your friends. Your friends invite you to go to a party. People are dancing. Some, you know, they're eating food, music, right, enjoying. And I say, come on, let's go to the dance floor, Masha. Come on. I say, no, it doesn't interest me. What do you mean it doesn't interest you? Look at those people, you know, they're like these mantises, moving their legs and arms here and there. What are they doing? Is that really dancing? They think they're dancing. They're like, something wrong with you. You know, they'll start talking then after that, in their little circle, your friend of, you know, their circle of friends, they'll start talking about you. They say, something's wrong with him. He needs help, intervention. And then they will intervene. They will. They'll take you to a psychiatrist. How do I know this? First-hand experience. But then, you know, if you are the right kind of people to bump into, then good things will happen to the psychiatrist. Such encounters are also possible in this asana. But that is what people are, you know, out there. I sometimes remind myself, you know, the number of TV channels that we used to have, and they still are. When you go into a restaurant, the number of different, you know, just the sheer variety of food items on a menu card. Just think, folks, have with a modicum of compassion, just examine a menu card. Now, most of you, because you have now become anagarikas, sravakas, sravikas, you may not even remember what a menu card is. So one of these days I'll come and put one up on screen. This is what a menu card is. It's antique. You may not even remember what one looks like. So on a menu card, here's what they have. Okay? In case you can't remember. They have about 150 different types of rice. And then 235 different types of noodles. 60 different types of drinks. So when you go to the restaurant, they ask you, what would you like today, sir? You are bamboozled by all the choices you have. And that is why they say, chef's choice outside. It makes choosing easier. Soup of the day. So you don't have to go through the plethora of choices. Can I just have the soup of the day? But you want to know that you have the choice. That's a good feeling. I want to know I have the choice. But do you remember those visits to the restaurant? Three or four of you of the family, you'd go together. You sit down and then you ask, what are you going to have? What are you going to have? I mean, why do you need to ask someone else what they're going to have? Because you're not sure. When there are so many choices, what are you going to have? And there's another reason. You want to try a bit of many. So you order one, you make sure that someone else is not having that. So you can try that as well. As a family, that's what you do. So again, you're looking for variety. You ask, Amma, what are you going to have? Tata, what are you going to have? Dua, what are you going to have? Don't have that one, I ordered that one. And the same goes for drinks as well. And dessert, same goes. So you try and get as much variety on this table. And now you go through them, one by one, trying it out. And in case you're not, you know, you go with friends, let's say, and not very close friends, but say acquaintances, you know, you can't just dip into their sushi, can you? They're going to have theirs, you're going to have yours. But you look at that, you think, they seem to be enjoying that. Next time I come to the restaurant, that is what I'm going to try. Whilst eating already what you have ordered. See, you can't even enjoy the food that you have ordered and you have paid for because you're watching someone else eat something and he seems to be delighted by it. Now you can't even enjoy what you paid for. You didn't pay for his meal, you're paying for your meal, but you can't enjoy that. Why? Because someone else just opposite the table is having something else. And they're going, yum, this is my God, this is wonderful, isn't it? Delectable. And you're like, oh, I should have ordered that. Can we swap? So you can't even enjoy what you've paid for. Ladies in the house, you will have similar experiences when you dress up for an event. How much does a good sari cost? 10 rupees? Sometimes you pay tens, if not hundreds of thousands. So you adorn yourself with that, get your makeup done, do your hair, do your makeup, do all that, and then you go to the party. And all after going there, what do? Do you want one of these? What do? You look at yourself in the mirror? What do? You look at others. Did you pay for their saris? I mean, what you're trying to enjoy now, is that the one you paid for? No. The one that you paid for, the necklace that you paid for, the makeup that you paid for, the hair that you paid for, the dress that you paid for is all on you, but you're not enjoying it. Flawed. I tell you, it's flawed, it's completely flawed. And you fell for it. So sometimes you spend hours. I mean, it's not just the money. What about the time? Add up all the hours you've spent at a beauty parlor. And write it down on a piece of paper. Don't tell me what it is. The time you've spent at the hairdressers. The longest I've spent getting dressed was for my wedding. Because I had to dress up as a traditional dress. And my God, that was painful. All those layers of clothes that have to go on. That was the longest I'd spent dressing up. But then I realized, what must being a woman be like? Nothing against, I'm just saying, because my mother, seen her. Didn't have a sister in the family. So I don't know, not seen that. Later on had a wife, so I've seen a little bit of that. But, just think about it. You can't enjoy what goes on you. You've paid for it, you've spent the time for it, but you can't enjoy it. The necklace that goes on your neck, how many times do you see it after you put it on? Tell me. You put it on for others. How compassionate. Yet who is always fearful about it? Might someone snatch it from me? You always have to keep checking, right? Is it on me? Is it still on me? If you're on a bus, right, you travel somewhere, go somewhere, there are a lot of people around, you're looking at them, it seems a bit dodgy, right? You're always checking yourself. Have I got my necklace on? Got my earrings on? Got all my stuff on? So you're checking them so that someone else can enjoy. Really, you should be paid, shouldn't you, by others to dress up like that? But do you? No, you pay for it. See, flawed thinking. I'm giving you examples just to remind yourself how much you have changed thanks to the Buddha. The freedom that you're able to enjoy today, thanks to the Buddha. I used to carry my car keys with me. You have no idea how many times I was so scared. Right, you wanted the car key. Wait. The number of times I've been through that mental torture. And the more expensive the car, the more scared you get. Yes or no? Of course. Car keys, house keys, the lot. See, all that fear, for what? All because you wanted to carry this feeling with you that it is my car. What are cars made for? You know what pens are made for? What are cars made for? To own? Is it? No. To be driven around in. And must you be the driver? Must you? No. In fact, who least enjoys the ride? Today's not a good sermon. Who pays for the car? The owner. I'm talking about, you know, normal, you know, regular, usual arrangement. I'm not talking about one where you have a chauffeur. Okay? So you own your car. You saved up the money. You got out the loan. You bought the car. Right? And now you're paying, making your monthly payments. Miss two payments and they take the car away. All that. And still you even have to drive the car. So every time there's a vehicle approaching, the car slows down, the heart speeds up. They're inversely proportional, aren't they? Heart rate and car rate. Yeah, I'm very much against our Swami Nuhan says, our anagarikas, even going home. You know, even if it is like for a meritable deed or maybe a pinkam or something so on, I always say, do you have to? We send them, let them go, but I always ask them, do you have to? Must you? Must you go? Because as safe as we might be when we drive, remember, we are not on the road alone. How many cars approach from the other direction? Drunken people. And a pothole you don't see at night. You're driving fast. Something's on the road, an obstacle of some sort. Something's fallen on the road. It's been heavy rains, landslides. Sometimes Swami Nasa come and tell, like just last week, one of our monks came and said, Swami Nasa, my grandmother has passed away. I said, yes. Parents called, What do you want to do now? I have to go, haven't I? I said, must you? Of course, you know, we let them go. Because it is duty. But then I asked him the question, Swami Nasa, just think about this. You know, you're going to see a dead man, putting your life at risk. It's quite possible that when you get there, there'll be two funerals. I mean, that person's dead. It's not like you can revive them or give them the Dhamma. There's nothing you can do for them now. The transferring of merit you can do from here itself. But you have to go because we have to fulfill our duties. Something similar happened in my family, I'd have to do the same. We do it wholeheartedly, yes. But if you think about it logically, just logically, pure logically, right, you're going to see a dead man. But you're putting your life at risk to do that. So must we not go to a funeral from here on? No, that's not what I'm saying. Funerals have to be attended to. Pay your last respects. Sometimes it is so true, because that is the last time you can pay respects to them for a long time. They won't come back for a long time again, for another respect. But these are the expectations that you will have to live with in your lay lives. Out there, you know, people are crazy. People are crazy. Because when they feel vexed, what do? They relieve themselves from vexation. Don't you think that's crazy? Does relieving yourself from vexation treat the problem? Does it fix the problem? Does it bring the problem to an end? Does it close the problem? No. It only makes it what? Worse. It only makes it worse. So if someone's got a problem and they're doing the very thing that makes it worse, what would you call them? Crazy people. If you want to watch a film, what's the worst thing you can do? Tell me. Let's talk through why that is so. Not because I say so, clearly. If you want to watch a film, what is the worst thing you can do? Watch a film. Let's work out why that is. Right now your mind is vexing because the mind is looking for the object of its desire. I want to watch a film. So it's vexed. It expects pleasure to come from the film. But is pleasure in the film? Is it in the movie? Is it in the film? Certainly not. How do we know this? Because you thought the same last time you went to the theater. Last time you went to the cinema, you thought the same thing. And here you are again, wanting to watch the next one or the sequel. So this is proof that it is not in there. And there are those who do not wish to watch it. You know, this is simple logic that people don't see for some reason. So you're expecting this to make you happy. And then you go and sit down in front of it. Now you start watching it because your vexation is being addressed. Simple as that. Right? The object that you have been seeking is being given to you drop by drop. Now your vexation is being released. That relief from vexation you experience as pleasure. But because you misinterpret that, because you think that pleasure equals to happiness, now you think, so the film did make me happy. And then what happens? That ignorance that got you on this path is reinforced. So you think, yes, the film makes me happy. Now that reinforces that original bad logic. And then you think, okay, the next time this happens, I have to do it again. And you do it again, and again, and again, and again. You know, this is why, ladies and gentlemen, by this point, if you actually think about it, you know, people often ask, right, how come society advances so much? Why is it that technology has advanced so much? You know, those days you used to have black and white, then you got color, right? Those days you had a 2D, now it's 3D, and then now it's 4D and 5D, and how many Ds, I don't know now. And then you have the various dimensions. You had SD, then you had HD, and now you have what, 8K, 12K, 16K videos published. You got to wonder why it is that people want bigger, better, smoother, richer, more vivid, because the previous one didn't do it for them. But now it can no longer. It's like antibiotics. Why do they always caution you against taking strong antibiotics? I think most of you will know the answer to this because we've all been there. They caution you against taking strong antibiotics because if you take one and then the bacteria, they build up a resistance to it. You know, some of the population will be destroyed from that antibiotic, but there will be some who are strong, and that bacteria population will remain. They'll become resistant to it. So if they're resistant to that antibiotic, you can't use the same antibiotic again. Now you're going to have to find a stronger one. But the antibiotic, in just the same way that it kills the bacteria, what else does it kill? The patient taking it through its side effects. These are strong drugs. So just like antibiotics, every time you take one, the next one has to be stronger. That's why they say, if you're taking it, take the full course. Why do they advise you to take the full course? So that every germ, every bacteria, or every bacterium in that population can be destroyed. And none remain that become resistant to it. That's why they say, take the full course. Because if some remain, now they're partially, or at least fully, resistant to the antibiotic. So the next time they start to proliferate, you can't treat them with the same antibiotic. See, the same concept applies. People understand that for disease, those diseases, but they don't get it for desire. They understand that concept for antibiotics, they don't understand it for seeking pleasures. Because pleasure seems so, you know, people feel they're so entitled to pleasure. Only the poor seek pleasures, ladies and gentlemen. It's not the rich. Only poor people seek pleasures. I'm not talking about poor in money, I'm talking about poor in mindset. That is why you've got to be different. You can't be doing what the average Joe does and expect to achieve greatness, expect to achieve something that they haven't. If you do what people before you have done, you will end up the same place. But do something different. Excuse me. Do something else. Do something uncommon, unusual. You will end up in a different destination. You know what the Buddha said? The simile that he used. He said, the number of grains of sand I can hold on my fingertip, on my thumb tip, this is all that will do, I tell, as I say. This is all that will take a different approach, a different perspective, a different walk in life. The rest of them, inasmuch as every grain of sand on this earth will only do what they've always done. Because people are so addicted to pleasure. People are addicted to pleasure. That is why Nibbana even is such a struggle. Otherwise, you know, you might wonder, we've been listening to sermons so many years, right? I've been practicing the path, observing the precepts. How come I haven't become an arahant yet? Because of pleasure. Pleasure is the chain that keeps you wound and bound to samsara, pleasure. You need to contemplate on pleasure. You need to reflect on the reality of pleasure. This is your Buddhist practice. Whenever you sense pleasure, contemplate on the reality of it. Contemplate on its true nature. What is this pleasure? You know, we are going back to the sermons that we used to do many years ago. That is where most of us started, right? Talking about pleasure and vexation. And today we are talking about jati and separation. It's not two things, it's the same thing. A couple of weeks ago I explained to you, it's only once you separate can you now either engage with it or distance yourself from it. Aversion and delusion, or aversion and desire, are both products of the basic delusion. To either like something or dislike something, there has to be something. So we're talking about the same thing. Same thing as we used to talk about, but just a little bit more advanced, a little bit more detailed. Even last week I reminded you, how committed are you to this? Are you doing your 100%? It's important that you do. And there is a reason for that, ladies and gentlemen. Why you have to do your 100%? Because if you do your, say if you do 99%, and that 1% remains, your 1% that you could do but you're not doing, that 1% will begin to grow. It will begin to grow. It will begin to reproduce. And that 1% will take over. It will start catching up. It will become 2%, that will go on to become 4%, and 6%, 8%, 12%, 20%. But if you're doing your 100%, that's fine. It doesn't have to be the next one's 100%. If you're doing your 100%, then you're full on. You're there. You're always there. You become a threat to your defilements. You got to challenge your defilements. I mean, become a hero to yourself, I encourage you. Become a hero to yourself. I ask you, who's your hero? Who's your hero? I want you all to say, me, Swami Nansal, I am my hero. Not in a foolish way, not in an arrogant way, but because you know you do your 100%. You know, hand on heart, honest to your conscience, you know that I do everything I can. You know, think about a life like that. If you haven't achieved that yet, let's get there as soon as possible. A life where you know you're doing everything you can. No secrets, no hidden agendas, no doing what you're supposed to do when someone's watching you, but something else when no one's watching you. Because if you're that kind of person, you can't say you're doing your 100%, and then if I ask you who's your hero, you can't say me. You can say anyone but me. I speak to you like this because I know you've all come on this journey, you've come a long distance. Right? So there are a few things, you know, just little nigglies that you need to sort out. That will fast track you on this journey. Just little things. These are those little things. See, today I don't tell you don't do unmeritorious deeds. That would be an insult. Don't kill. Okay. I mean, leave aside the insult, it would be pointless talking to you and telling you don't kill, because you Why tell you things you don't do anyway? Now I'm beginning to talk to you about those little niggly things, you know, those little things that go unnoticed. Are you fully transparent? Give me a virtual nod, either this way or that way. Only a virtual one, don't do it for real. I want this question to reach to your conscience, and I want you to bring out an answer from your conscience. Are you fully transparent? What I see here, is that who you really are? Or have you got a mask on? When you claim to be a disciple of the Buddha, when you say Bhagavato tassa savako hamasmi, if the Buddha were here in person, would you say that? Would you walk up to the Buddha and say, Venerable Sir, you are the all-knowing one. I can't hide anything from you clearly. So, let me say this to you. Bhagavato tassa savako, and the Buddha's left. Because he doesn't want you to lie in front of a Buddha. That would split your head in seven. So he's done you the honor, and he's begun to take his leave. Come back later, Upasaka Mahatya. You're not ready to say that yet. I want you all to prepare yourselves for a life with no secrets. A holy life. If you indulge in sensuality, be upfront about it. I indulge in sensuality. That is better than a life where you do that, but then you hide behind everyone. I say, no, I don't. Because that is a dishonest life, an insincere life. Everyone who comes in front of the Buddha are those who have desire, aversion and delusion. That is fine. Right? You don't need to be an arahant to claim to be a Bhagavato tassa savaka. But you have to be upfront. You have to be open. You have to be transparent. Can I see you the way the Buddha sees you? I'm not talking about my ability here. I'm talking about the Buddha sees you, he scans you, he sees you, every bit of you. Because he has this ase anuse jnana, the knowledge with which one can see dormant defilements. So there's no hiding from him. When you take yourself in front of your teacher, I don't mean in public, I mean you take yourself in front of your teacher, do you expose yourself to your teacher as if it was the Buddha in front of you? Because to the Buddha you don't need to expose yourself, right? He'll see you head to toe in every aspect that you are. But in front of your teacher, of course you know that your teacher cannot scan you in this way. They'll only know what you tell them or what they suspect, perhaps. And so, I mean, this is not typically advice I would give to people, you know, to just live a lay life. This is not advice I'd give them. In fact, this is usually advice I'd share with our monks, anagarikas and anagarikas. But, you know, bring me lay people, I'll talk to them. There are no lay people here, that's a problem. Everyone's on the holy path, the noble path, in every bit of the way they can. Everyone's doing their 100%. At least I believe you are. So in that 100%, I tell you, be transparent. Be like pure glass, not frosted glass, pure glass. Fully transparent, 100%. What is on one side is what you can see from the other side. If you're not there yet, then do something about it, is what I'm asking you to do. Do something about it. Don't be there forever. It's not a nice feeling to be that way. Do something about it. Change yourself, improve yourself, work on yourself so that you can be who you claim to be. So your fitting of that prayer mat, that goes on your shoulder. You can claim to be, or you can be who you claim to be. If you're in robes, I tell you, venerable sirs, be fitting. If you have a prayer mat on your shoulder, be fitting. If you observe the Gahatta Dasa Sikkha Padam on a regular basis, if you bring yourself here as an Upasaka or an Upasaka every day, every other day, every week, every other week, whatever, be fitting of that. Improve yourself, work on yourself so that you can be fitting towards that which you claim to be. You know, the Buddha, when he sat down beside the Bodhi tree, he said, "I shall not get up until I am fitting to my ambition. Until I have achieved what I have come here for. Until I have achieved and claimed the kingdom of the Buddhas, I shall not get up. I will keep working on myself. I will keep striving. I will keep going through this internal transformation until I have achieved the pinnacle of my success." You know, that is what we are here for. You all know who you'd like to be. That is the picture that you show to the outside. Now, transform your inside to be one with that. Not two. They should overlap. These two hands, they don't overlap. See? There's a thumb sticking out here and there's another thumb sticking out here. They don't overlap. But if I had two left hands, I could overlap them. I can do this and pretend to overlap. But they're not the same. That's why if you try and put one over the other, they don't. But I can pretend by doing this. Because they're mirror images. But a mirror is not a glass. It's not a transparent glass. On the mirror, your left becomes your right, and your right becomes your left. But as you stand in front of a glass that is not a mirror, just a plain glass like this one here, what you see is what you get. Work towards that. Not for others, work towards that. So that you don't have to pretend. You don't have to be someone unnaturally. Become that person naturally. And all you got to do is do what you've always been doing, but do it even more. Do it better. Do it more fiercely. Do it more passionately. Do it more acutely. Do it more vigorously. Do it wholeheartedly and purposefully. Work on your defilements. Identify them and continue to work on your defilements. Take your thinking back to the core principles of the Dhamma. Whenever you experience pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, don't drop the hat there. Work on it. Don't wait until you are 95 to become an arahant. I speak to our young anagarikas and our anagarikas, our noble heart children. I say, "Buddha, by the time you reach my age, if you are not an arahant, you will have me to answer to." Because at their age, I didn't have someone like me or my teachers to guide us. But they've got everyone. They've got all of you. You know, children with noble hearts, by the time they reach, 30, what do you expect from them? Robbers? What do you expect from them? Great arahants, no? Yeah, that's what we expect from them as well. Not for us, not for our sake, but so that they can live their lives freely. They can live their lives without suffering. Fear doesn't bother them, grief doesn't bother them, sorrow doesn't bother them. A free life. An enjoyable life, black or white, doesn't matter. Hot or cold, don't matter. Up or down, whatever. Here or there, wherever. What a free life. I want all of you to get there. You know, we started late in life. Yes, I understand that. Some of us started in our teens, others started in our 20s, 30s, 30 teens, and 50 teens. You know, you're still teens, you're all teens. Even if you're 80, you're still a teen. You're just 80 teen, not 18. Still teens. But we started late. But that's okay, because we know the story of the rabbit and the hare. Not the rabbit and the hare and the tortoise. Right? It doesn't matter if you started late, you're doing what you need to do, you can get where you want to be. So starting late is not an excuse. So when you started, whether your hair was black or white, it's alright. If your back was straight or crooked, it's fine, not to worry, because your chitta is just brand new. It has every opportunity. But what matters is us doing this. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to envisage, right? Dream of a state of mind where you are free of desire. Just dream of that. Just have that picture in your mind. You know, isn't that a wonderful dream? A state of mind where you are free of desire. Matters not what people say to you. Matters not what people don't say to you. You don't have to go like a dog, right? Behind whatever. Food doesn't bother you. Colors don't bother you. Sights don't bother you. Sounds don't bother you. Smells don't bother you. An unblemished character. People always get what they see. A compassionate heart. Why is it that people struggle to care about others? Because they're far too busy doing what? Caring about themselves. That's why they can't care about others. So if anyone comes up and says, Swami Nansa, I want to live my life, a life where I do things for others. I care about others. Good. All you got to do is stop caring about yourself. How do you do that? How do you stop caring about yourself? By first caring about yourself. Because there's something you need to do to exterminate yourself, to extinguish yourself, completely eradicate yourself, uproot yourself. Once you've done that, there is no more self to care about. And then you just become a force of nature, a good force of nature. Look at the trees, ladies and gentlemen. The trees out there. Does the tree pick and choose who it gives shelter to? Does it? Imagine an oak tree. A massive oak tree. Does it pick and choose who it gives shelter to? Does it? If you have a mango tree at home, does it pick and choose who it gives its fruit to? Does it? It doesn't. So who does it give to? Whoever needs it. A tree gives shelter to whoever needs it. No preferences, no choices. If you cut the tree down, does the oak tree cry? Does the mango tree cry? No. If you don't need me anymore, then you can do as you wish. This is what nature is like. A tree is a creation of nature. And so are you all. You're all a creation of nature. Think about the wind. When the wind blows, it brings its cooling effect on everybody. If you don't like the wind, you can spit at the wind. What do you think the wind is going to do? It will still blow. It's cool and soothing breeze. Swear at the wind if you like. You know, when I get home today, don't do it at the monastery, people will watch. When you get back home today, right, get onto the rooftop and you start swearing at the wind. You wreck it, wind. Don't you ever come back this way, I hate you. You're disgusting. Surprise, surprise, 2 minutes later the wind will blow. Bringing with its bring with it its cooling and soothing effect. And if you're so tired and exhausted after all that swearing and shouting at it, it will cool you down as it blows. Not looking for your gratitude. It will not say, you didn't thank me yesterday, so I'm not going to come your way. No, doesn't do that. No expectations, zero expectations, but 100% fulfillment. This is the nature of an arahant. Here's our aspiration. I want you all to aspire to be that kind of person. That's why I say, dream of a state of mind, dream of a world. I don't mean the world outside, I mean your world. Dream of a world where you are free of desire. There you are not fighting for yourself, because you don't sense yourself. Then you become a good force of nature, like a tree, like the wind, like the water, like the earth. This is the advice the great Buddha gave Rahula. Become like the wind, Rahula. No expectations, only fulfillment, only reward. Always gives us reward. Doesn't pick and choose. But we can't be like that if we have preferences. You know, sometimes, maybe not so now, but those days, you know, you used to pick and choose who you smiled at. Some people used to smile at, others you didn't because you didn't like them. But sometimes, you know, there are people who would have done good deeds, right? Maybe there's someone, you see, he's gone and helped a poor man. Given him something, you know, some of his food, his lunch, right? You don't congratulate him. You don't say, well done, because you don't like that guy. Hypocritical. Because it doesn't make you happy to see him happy. That's why. There would have been a time in your lives where you only wanted some people in this world to be happy. And who do those people belong to? Me. And some people, they don't need to be happy. In fact, if they're happy, I'm not so happy. So therefore, you know, this is what Guru Hamdur always says. If you pick a camp in this world, if you pick a side in this world, you can only enjoy half of its beauty. The whole world is beautiful. Not just half of it. But is that so for you, genuinely? Is the whole world beautiful to you? Is black and white the same to you? Do you see the beauty in black in as much as you see the beauty in white? You see a young, youthful person, taut skin, tanned, upright, standing, right, nice hair. You say, oh, what a sight to behold. And then you see an old achiamma, a granny. I can't even stand up straight. Walking with a walking stick, right? Crooked. Old skin, right? She's falling apart. Can you see the beauty in that achiamma? Can you see her beauty? Or in her, do you see a beast? Sometimes young people, you know, they don't like old people. If you don't know what that feels like, wait for it. Soon enough, you'll be an old person in and amongst young people. And then you'll know what it feels like to be an old person amongst people who don't like old people. We'll all find that out, what that feels like. Some people just don't like old people. Because they're yucky, they're old. They're not new, they're old. Wrinkled skin. Blemished skin. As if it's contagious. That's how they treat them sometimes. Not smooth and fine, but very coarse. You know that as you get older, look at your fingernails or your toenails. They'll start wrinkling up. They'll take some odd, weird shapes. That's not how it's supposed to be. Some people will find that repulsive, because they can't see the beauty in that. That's the reason. But I tell you, that's beautiful. It's very beautiful. I don't know if what I'm saying is making sense to you, but to me, all things are beautiful. The young is as beautiful as the old, and the old is as beautiful as the young. Nice taut skin and wrinkled old skin. Beautiful, they're both beautiful. Grey hair, black hair, both beautiful. Are you seeing this beauty? I want you to be able to see this beauty. Fresh and rotten. One is yes, yes, the other no, no. Why? I don't mean for consumption, but if you find things repulsive, there's a problem with you, your mind is diseased. Identify that. What is repulsive is not that, the fact that you are diseased. That is what is repulsive. The things that ought to be repulsed are desire, aversion and delusion, not the things out there. See, when people are given a nice hearty meal, they bring everyone round the table, they sing, they rejoice, they talk about the food, they discuss that, how did you make that, isn't this wonderful, isn't that scrumptious, you know, would you like to have some, this, that and the other. But in 6 hours, 12 hours, right, that is down the toilet, and then they flush it like it is not them who are responsible for it. Look away, turn the seat down, and then flush it, like it wasn't I who did that. Honestly, you know, just imagine this, right? Just imagine you were going out somewhere. Okay, let's not say you, some man. Okay, and they needed the toilet. There's no washroom to be found. But they, you know, because when you need to go, right? So, they have to go and take a call of nature, a long call of nature. And then some passerby asks, who did that? Not you, okay? Not you. Do you think that man, not you, would be able to say, I did that? That's mine. Chances are very slim that they can man up and actually say, yep, I did that. But you know, if they wore a perfume and said, whose is that? It's me. It's mine. That's me. I'm the one who's smelling nice. See? Why can't you appreciate the beauty of that? It's beautiful. If you think I'm crazy, I'm sorry to say you're crazy. An arahant doesn't repulse things in this world because the only thing that is worth repulsing has been completely eradicated. If there are still things in this world where you look at it and go, ugh, please take that away from me. I don't like the look of it. I don't like the smell of it. It's disgusting. Please come to your senses. You are diseased. There's an ailment in the mind. See, there are things in this world that can take away your happiness. Work on yourself. That's all I'm saying. Work on yourself. It's okay that it's like that, but it's not okay forever. It's okay for now, not forever. So work on yourself so that you can look at it and go, yeah. It's a bodily process. Not my process, a bodily process. In as much as digestion or eating is a bodily process, then excretion is a bodily process. It's a bodily process. So what? If someone comes up on stage and sings a song, right? Let's say we're all blindfolded. One of you come up here, you're all blindfolded, someone sings a song. And you think it's a beautiful song. At the end of that, you all want to know what? Who was that? And the person who sang also wants what? For everyone else to know that it was them. Right, let's say we're blindfolded again. And someone passes wind. Someone passes wind. Now, yes, still, people want to know who that was. But the person who did that doesn't want anyone to find out. Why? Because that when it came out this way, it was mine. When it came out that way, I don't want it to be mine. Why can't you appreciate the beauty of a fart? Why only the beauty of a song? They are both melodious. But to be so, here you got to be free. You got to be relaxed. You can't be tensed. That's why I said, if you are that kind of person, you will always split this world up into, and only one half will ever be beautiful. The other half will always bring you, you know, then you have heaven and hell. You create your own heaven, you create your own hell. Because you only like half of this world. If you like black, you don't like white. Then you'll always have to go looking for where you like to be. You'll always have to keep roaming. That is what you're doing in samsara, roaming in samsara, looking for the places you like to be. This is what roaming is. Roaming in samsara. Always looking for the places you like to be. Looking for the people you like to be with. Looking for the sights you like to see. Always looking for it. But just imagine if anywhere was fine. If all sights are the same. If you could look at all things equanimously. Now where would you have to be? Where would you need to be? You're fine just where you are. Then you can stop roaming. If you can truly become a citizen of nature, aspire to that. Not a citizen of Sri Lanka. Because if you are a citizen of Sri Lanka, you'll always want to come back to Sri Lanka. If you're a citizen of America, wherever you travel in the world, you'll always feel like you're an American. If you come from Australia and you feel that is your citizenship, you'll always feel like you have to go back to Australia, because no matter where you go, you'll always feel, I belong to Australia. But what if you can belong to nature? Where do you find nature? In Australia? In England? In Germany? In Spain? In Portugal? Where do you find nature? Nature is everywhere. The whole universe is nature. The whole universe. I'm not just talking about a global citizen. I'm talking about a universal citizen. Become a citizen of nature. Aspire to that. When you're a citizen of nature, whatever Mother Nature gives you, you've got to be able to embrace that. If nature is your mother, then whatever she gives you, that is your heritage. You've got to be able to accept that. How do you get there? You've got to be able to not see the world through a lens that separates things. That is how. Once you look at the world through the lens of Dhamma, you realize that all there is the same thing, just in a different arrangement. That's all. Just the same things. You know, all these objects you see on this desk, right? There's a heap of betel leaves, cup of water, clock, some flowers on a tray, pens, a duster, voice recorders, microphones, right? All these things. They're simply arrangements of matter manifesting differently, that's all. But for that, you've got to be able to see the world like that. But if you see the world as separate things, and you can't help it, if inside you feel separate. Separate from what? Separate from everything else. That is your identity. You feel you're unique, don't you? Your uniqueness is your curse. It's not your blessing. The very thing that you think you are, you know, your very identity is your curse. It's not your blessing. That is what we are trying to destroy. Your very identity. You know, here we are trying to become no one, not become someone. Because when you're someone, everyone else is someone else. It's the perfect trap. Because whenever you become someone, you have to fight for that someone. And then everyone's fighting for themselves, now the whole world can exist. That's the perfect trap. But if you can see all these things, on this desk, if you can see all these things as merely manifestations of the same matter, arranged in different ways, these are just purely configurational changes, that's all. When you turn up the dials on a voice record, not a voice record, a voice player, sorry, music player, or a mixer, if you've seen those mixers that people use to adjust the audio for a setting, right? You turn up the dials, you know that these are only configuration changes. You can always go back to a previous state, right? You can always change the state, go back to a previous state. Because that setting is purely just an arrangement at that moment. See, you know the difference between this? Let me see. The difference between this and this, a different setting. It's a difference in Patavi. It's a difference in Apo, difference in Tejo, and difference in Vayu. It's merely a difference in the pure octave, Varna, Gandhara, Soja, along with Patavi, Apo, Tejo, Vayu. It's just a different setting. So if this is, say, 20% Patavi, perhaps this is 15% Patavi. It's the same matter, just rearranged. But they manifest differently because, and therefore they have different qualities. You can eat this, you can chew on this, and nothing harmful would happen to you, but try that with this, you'll have to go to the doctor. Same matter, but when configured in a different way, it has a different quality, a different characteristic. You know, like an audio mixer. Let me give you a demo. Right? So, right now, can you turn up the... Does it allow you to turn up the bass, treble and so on your mixers? Yes? Alright. So, this is the normal setting that they have. Right? Let's turn up the treble and turn down the bass fully. So now, we've turned up the treble and turned down the bass. The quality is different, isn't it? That's all that is different. Just a different setting. It's not fixed, it's just a different setting. The same dials you can now reset. Full bass and zero treble, please. And this is what you get. Yes? Are we there? Oh, there we go. So how do you know? Different quality. See, that's right. Patavi, Patavi. But different settings. Therefore, different qualities. In the audio, you can actually sense that quality, that difference in quality. Here, you can sense it if you try to eat it. If you hold it, if you, you know, crush it, you can sense that. Now, go back to our standard setting. Give us some reverb. Let's make some music. Yeah? Is that fixed? No. But is it not a different quality? The characteristics are different. Because the settings are different. That all, you know, this setting, the reverb setting, was also set previously, but to a very low level. Now we've just turned it up. On the previous occasion, the base was set to a standard level, you know, a normal level, an average level. But then it was turned all the way up. That is why you got a different quality, a different characteristic. In the first experiment, we turned the treble all the way up and the bass all the way down, and then a different characteristic. All three of them, the bass, the treble, the reverb, all three of them are always there. They're always there, just different settings at different events, different situations. Right, let's get back to normal. What is normal then? Is this normal? It's just a setting. That's why I ask you, is it right or wrong for the pen to have this cap on another pen? Is this right? Is this right? Is this right? Or is it wrong? How can you say it's wrong? If it's wrong, how can you have this? These are just configurational changes, ladies and gentlemen. This is what I want you to get your heads around. All of what you see are just configurational changes of the same stuff. Patavi, apo, tejo, vayo, varna, gandha, rasa, oja. This is the pure octave. Ultimately, all of that is also energy. The reason that on some occasions energy manifests as patavi is because there's a force acting on that energy. That is the shape that that energy has taken. It manifests as patavi. It's just energy. Energy can manifest as patavi, it can manifest as vayu, it can manifest as tejo, and so on. In the same way, energy can manifest as rupa. That it does only in a chitta. Energy can manifest as vedana. Where does it do that? In a chitta. Because the chitta is the only structure in which rupa, vedana, sanya, sankhara and vijnana can manifest. See, as an example, energy can manifest as sound only in that speaker, or through that speaker. Energy can manifest as light only through a bulb. It cannot do that through the fan. See, different structures allow different manifestations of the same energy. The electricity board sends us energy through the wires, right? That comes as electrical energy. Because in a wire, what do you get? Electrical energy. That is the manifestation that structure allows. But plug that wire to a fan, what do you get now? Mechanical energy, kinetic energy. Because that arrangement, that structure allows for that manifestation. So you see, this is the energy, this is also energy. Energy and matter, one and the same. Energy is matter, matter is energy. If you don't believe the Buddha, at least believe Einstein. Thankfully, he said the same thing. Right? Energy is matter and matter is energy. Just in a different arrangement. But once you put it to a certain structure, there are certain qualities that it possesses. That is why what you can do with water, you can't do with ice. What you can do with ice, you can't do with water. Don't you agree? What can you do with water that you can't do with ice? Wash. There you go. What can you do with ice that you can't do with water? You can't throw it 300 meters. But a piece of ice, you can. You can't throw water that far. Well, you can, but it travels better as ice. And you can keep it on a desk without a container. See, that you can't do with water because it flows. It's just the same stuff, different arrangements. And why are we interested in different arrangements? Because of the qualities that they then present to us. That is why as human beings, our study of science, ladies and gentlemen, our study of chemistry, our study of physics, our study of biology and the various other sciences is so that we understand how we can get the characteristics that we want, the qualities that we want from Mother Nature, from rearranging the things that nature gives us. How can we get our wants, our desires, our needs fulfilled? Because we have various needs. Now you can't eat a tree, but you can eat an apple. You can't eat soil, but you can eat an apple. I mean, someone says, I'm vegetarian, I don't eat meat. The animal dies, becomes soil. The tree absorbs it, makes a fruit. Now you eat it. So put your hand up if you think you're a vegetarian. Put your hand up if you think you're non-vegetarian. There's no such thing. We are only matterarians or energetarians. All we take is energy. We can think to ourselves, you see, one who believes that they're a vegetarian, like I used to remember my old story. If you think you're a vegetarian, again, you're looking at the world as a fixed thing. Because there are meat things and there are non-meat things. That's a fixed view of the world. If you think you're a non-vegetarian, again, you're taking a fixed view of the world. Now think about it. What was his name? Devadatta. There, approached the Buddha. Right? And he asked the Buddha to lay down 5 rules of conduct for the monks. And he said one of them should be that all monks should be vegetarian. Without an understanding of this doctrine, of this philosophy, you might think, you know, how virtuous Devadatta was. See, how virtuous Devadatta was. Why could the Buddha not, in all his compassion towards all sentient beings, have not laid down that rule and said all bhikkhus and bhikkhunis should be vegetarians? Because to the Buddha, this thing makes no sense. This claim makes no sense. This request makes no sense. Because he doesn't see the world as animals, birds and bees. Or he doesn't see the world as flora and fauna. He sees the world as just matter arranged in different ways. Of course, you know, people will say various things. And when because we have to live coherently and cohesively with everyone, right? And we have to be able to interact with others and not you know, become victim of their accusations, right? Therefore, for the continuation of the Buddha Sasana, from time to time he would have laid down certain rules and ways of conduct. But he understands the world as energy configured in different ways. So to him, if you ask him, should monks be vegetarians? I can understand now why he said no. Those who choose to be vegetarians, may they be. Those who choose to be non-vegetarians, then let them be. Because neither of those practices are against Buddhist philosophy. But if you see the world as that, then again you're separating this world into two things. You're seeing fixed things, that's the problem. If for health reasons, you have chosen a lifestyle of vegetarianism, then it's fine. Because that you understand, because again, they have qualities, right? Meat, it has a different quality to vegetables, different qualities. You know, sometimes food, matter, the same matter arranged in a certain way is easier to digest. Some food arranged in a certain way, like it can be poisonous, it can be harmful to the body. But in another configuration, it is harmless. If you take venom, for instance, the venom is venomous, it kills, right? But if you take the chemical components, right, break it down into its individual elements, it's the same stuff that goes into making everything else. It's the same stuff that goes into making your pudding. But in one form, it's a neurotoxin. In another form, it's a tongue pleaser. Same stuff. Just a different arrangement, because in different arrangements they have different qualities. We are interested in these qualities because we need to be able to do things in life. Like if you want to sit, you need something that is hard. You can't have something soft to sit on. So therefore you need more patavi. So if you were to make something to sit on, what arrangements would you have there? A lot of patavi. Yeah, you need something that is hard, something that is solid. So keep packing more of that stuff. And less of the vayu stuff. That's it. But if you want to breathe, now if you want to wash, if you want to drink, right? Now too much patavi is not going to be able to do it for you. You need less patavi. More apu, more tejo, more vayu. So let's make sure that we understand the world as it really is. Once you begin to see the world through this lens, what you begin to understand is Just as all things in this world are pure manifestations, meaning arrangements of energy, then the same goes here as well. Because one might question, how is my understanding of all these things being the same going to help me to attain Nibbana? How is that going to help me? How does that make me perceive less of the self? If I begin to see all these things as processes, Swami Nansa, okay, I understand that. But how is that going to help me? Because really, what I'm asking you to do is not to try and understand the logic behind this. I'm not trying to explain to you the makeup of this leaf. I'm trying to explain to you the principle behind the makeup of this leaf, not the leaf. Because the principle is the same. The same principle goes into making everything. Right? The elements that go into making this may be very different to the elements that go into making this. What we need to specialize in is not those elements and how they make up these objects. So our study is not in how to make a leaf or how to make a duster. It is in understanding that these things are all made. That is what we're trying to understand, that these are all manufactured. Not the manufacturing of X or the manufacturing of Y, but manufacturing, the principle of manufacturing. All things are manufactured. All things are causative. They are based in causes and they will only prevail for as long as the causes prevail. This is why they're called effects. As soon as you turn down the causes or turn off the causes, the effects will turn off. So the effects cannot be independent of the causes. They'll always be together. In fact, when you provide the causes, you don't need to bring in an effect from anywhere. Those causes themselves manifest the effect. I'll give you an example. Think about this. Remember the other day we talked about the word no and on? Right? I'll take another word today. Okay. Think about this. What do you say? Star. Think about why you see star, not why you see stars. If someone knocked you on your head, you'll see stars. That's not why. Think about why you look at this and you perceive star. Let's talk through what some of those causes are. S is one of the causes. In fact, you know, if this was... Now do you see star? No. Now you see ta. Yeah. If this was N, you don't see star, right? So you don't perceive star. So therefore, S is a cause. Is that the only cause? No. What other causes do you see? T. So I'm gonna mark the causes. All right. Let's see how many causes we can identify. You might think that we are actually specializing in star. That's the idea that you probably get right now. So we are learning star. That's okay, but then I'll explain to you the reason behind doing this. So first of all, let's identify the causes. Here's one. Next, another one. Yeah. Another one here. Okay, so here you identify how many causes? There's four causes so far, right? What about the fact that S is next to T? That's another cause, isn't it? Right, that's another one there. How about the fact that T is next to A? That's another one. A next to R? That's another one. What else do you see as causes? How about the fact that ST are next to AR? What if AR was ahead of S and T? That wouldn't work either, would it? So that's another cause. What else? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, another 4 there. What if this was this way? The T was upside down. I mean, it's just a letter. If you turn it upside down, you don't perceive it as a letter. Because really, I haven't written anything on here. You think I've written a word here. In fact, you think this is English. I just drew some scribbles on the board. Let me draw some scribbles on the board. You tell me what you think it is, okay? In fact, I'm not even going to look at the board. You tell me what you think it is. Uh, I'm just drawing some scribbles on the board. Why are you saying it's, oh, it's a bee? Huh. I only just realized that. See, I didn't even intend to draw a bee. I'm just drawing some scribbles. Okay, let's try another one. What is that? Hold on. I'll make it something for you. I'm not drawing anything I drew initially. I'm not erasing any of that. What do you see now? R? And? I. Did I draw that? I wasn't intending to draw that. I was just drawing some scribbles. But you perceive them as certain things because you see a connection between these things. See, this line is connected to this line, is connected to this line, is connected to this line. That connection you have in your own mind. See, how many causes going to make in this R? And then if you know something as R, right, you think, this is that one. These are all creations of your own mind. So, stop. Now you're seeing lots of causes here. What if I rearrange these letters? Now I've just written the same thing in reverse order. Rats. See, it's the same letters but in reverse order. How is it that I can simply change the arrangement and give you a different manifestation? When you think the word star, do you get the same feeling and emotion as when you see rats? Do you? No, that is why. When you see this, you get a different emotion to when you see this. Different arrangement. That's it. That's why water and ice you perceive as different things and they have different arrangements, so therefore different qualities. See? Different qualities. You know well and truly that when you see this, you get a different emotion, a different emotional response to when you see this. But it's the same letters, different arrangement. Now do you understand that the whole world is the same, ladies and gentlemen? The whole world is the same. All there is are different arrangements of the same stuff. That's why we say nothing is fixed. There are no fixed things. That's why this, I can simply take these letters out, arrange them in a certain way, in another way, and give you a completely different emotional response. Or ignite within you a different emotional response. All of that is possible because of the nature of anicca. So, what then is dukkha? How do we understand dukkha through this? Let's try and... Yes. See, this is a very subtle point, but I think you can all, because we've all come this far, you can understand what I'm going to try to explain to you. When you see this word star, okay, you perceive that this word is actually star, that there's a star here, not an actual star, but you think that the word here is star. You don't perceive this as simply an arrangement of letters in a certain order. You see, actually perceive star, because that's why it ignites within you an emotional response to this, right? That is dukkha. Not this is dukkha. It's not the star that is dukkha. In your mind, your perceiving there to be a fixed thing here is dukkha. So dukkha is a condition of the mind. Dukkha is a condition of the mind. A state of the mind. It's a state, right? So the mind can be either with dukkha or without dukkha. When the mind is with dukkha, you look at a physical object out there and you think that is there. It's not an arrangement, but rather it's a fixed thing. It's an entity. This entity-based thinking, this unitary thinking, is characteristic of dukkha. So why then does the Buddha say, yadanicchantan dukkha? And here's why. Because if what there is anicca, if anicca is the nature of all things, then the reason that you see an outside world object and you think that it exists as an entity is because in your mind, dukkha is what is taking place right now. So he's actually diagnosing the problem when he says, yadanicchan tan dukkhan. You can almost think of the Buddha doing this. Puts a stethoscope. Yadanicchan tan dukkhan. Do you get that? He's got the stethoscope on. He's examining you, placing the stethoscope on your chest, listening to the murmurs of the chest, right? Breathe in. Breathe out. Yadanicchan tan dukkhan. In other words, if anicca is the nature of all things, as you can see, this is purely an arrangement. If all there are arrangements, and if in the mind also there is only an arrangement, how is the mind an arrangement? Because what is the mind after all? Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sankara, Vijnana. And if jati is happening in the mind, then we know the process of jati. It's a process-driven phenomenon, right? So you have avidya, or ignorance, and then the expectation of pleasure, right? Then you have the bhava, abhisankara, you have the bhava, you have the jati, right? So that is also a manifestation, in as much as this is a manifestation. In fact, let me just take a short detour. We know this process of ignorance, and then you have the expectation of pleasure, you have attachment, yeah? You have becoming, and you have jati. I'm just trying to explain an important point here. Why is this star? It's not just because of the causes, but the order of these causes also determine that this is star. What if we were to change the order of these causes? So instead of ignorance and expectation here, we take out attachment from here and we put it here. And then straight up to becoming, and then take out jati from here and actually put it up here. This becomes jati, and then this becomes becoming, and then this becomes expectation. You know, this is just madness. Then I'm going crazy here. This makes no sense. This makes no sense because now it's the same causes, yes, but a very different arrangement. Because it's a different arrangement, it does not manifest as jati. It won't manifest as jati. Just like if these causes were rearranged, you get a different product. If this were the case, perhaps, you know, it would have been something else, but certainly not jati. Jati won't happen that way. For jati to happen, it has to be in that order and those causes coming together in that order. So don't you see that jati is purely and wholly and characteristically anicca? What is anicca? Causes and their order. Why is this manifesting as a betel leaf? Causes in that order. Why is this as manifesting as a cloth? Causes in that order. See, the alignment of causes is as important as those causes themselves. That whole thing is part of anicca. Now, therefore, this is jati because of the causes in that order. So therefore, jati is also characteristically anicca. So therefore, if yadanicca, if anicca is the nature of all things, then what is it that is happening to you right now? Has to be jati. Because remember, the Buddha is a doctor, isn't he? He's come to diagnose. He's come to diagnose, to give the treatment, and then to help you heal. So if he's a doctor, he's come here to examine what's gone wrong with us. So he examines the mind and he tells us, jati. So he studies the symptoms. Once he studies the symptoms, he sees that all there is anicca. So if all there is anicca, then this can't be anything other than jati. It can't be self, certainly. Why can't it not be self? What is self not based in? Causes. Exactly. What are the causes for self? Are there causes or are there no causes? You can't answer that question. You really can't answer that question, because how can you answer a question about something that doesn't exist? We don't know what the causes for self are, because it's never manifested. We've never had that, we don't expect to have it, but you know, it's never been there, so we don't know what the causes for self are. All we know are the causes for things that are. Jati is, self isn't. We've never seen self. We've never come across it. Have you? Have you ever come across self? No, we've never come across self. All we have come across is the sense of self. Sense of self is a product of jati, not self. In fact, self, we don't know whether self gives you the same feeling. We don't know that. Why don't we know that? Because self has never been. But what gives the sense of self? In fact, you know, it's like me saying, if Santa were real, I don't know whether he'll give gifts or not. I don't know. Honestly, I wouldn't know. Maybe he might give gifts, maybe he might not. Because we don't know. We have never seen Santa. Who have we seen? People who dress like Santa, and they give gifts. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm giving an analogy here. Yeah? So people who dress like Santa, they give gifts. So if you ask me, does Santa also give gifts? What do I have to say? I don't know. Show me Santa, I'll tell you. So then bring me Santa. Where is Santa? Where do you go find him? You can't. So does Santa give gifts? Yes or no? Huh? Answer, yes or no? Asking the wrong question. You can't answer yes, because we've never received gifts from Santa. You can't answer no, because we don't know what the heck Santa does. We've never met him. But do people who dress like Santa, do they give gifts? Yes. That's why we don't talk about a self here. Because we don't, actually, in fact, you know, even the Buddha didn't know what self was. See, in all his wisdom, he didn't know what the self was. But there were other teachers in the day. They knew self, but the Buddha didn't. There are things even Buddhas don't know. In their omniscience, they still don't know some things, such as self. What is self? Buddha will say, asking the wrong question. Because ask me something I know and I can tell you about it. Ask me something I don't know, how can I answer? But ask him about the sense of self, this perception of self, and the Buddha says, that I can answer. This perception of self is based in jati. Jati is a condition of the mind, it's a disease of the mind, and when that disease takes over, now you sense a self. Is that self? Can't answer that, because we don't know what self is. See, in that way, yadanichantam dukkham. If all there is anicca, I mean, anicca is not a thing, you understand that now, right? Last week I was struggling to understand, explain what anicca was. I said, anicca. Anicca is this. Well, anicca is this. Is anicca. Like, sometimes I wonder, why don't you understand what anicca is? I mean, if all there is, that's like you ask me, what is nature? Huh? What do you mean, what is nature? All there is nature. How do you explain what anicca is? Anicca is anicca, and the reason you're asking me this question is also because of anicca. Because the causes haven't lined up for you to understand what anicca is. That's why. Anicca is anicca, that is all there is. It means cause and effect. It means there are effects because of causes. It means the effects cannot be removed from the causes. It means only as long as the causes will prevail, will the effect prevail. All of that is anicca. All you see is anicca. All you hear is anicca. All you smell, taste, touch, and all you sense is anicca. Everything is anicca. The whole world is anicca. That's all there is. This is Hetupalabhava. And if all there is anicca, then the disease that you have in the mind must also be a product of anicca. Therefore, jati. Jati is a product of anicca. Because jati is a product of causes. Turn off the causes, you've turned off the effect of jati. Therefore, jati is not fixed. But the irony of it is, jati gives you the impression of fixed. So this perception of fixedness is also thanks to anicca, non-fixedness. Thanks to non-fixedness, you perceive fixedness. That is the nature of this. So, yadanicca tandukkam then, because of this nature of anicca, we have jati. So if jati is what there is, then why do you say it is a self? Why do you claim it to be a separated thing? Because jati is not a separated thing, is it? Why do we say jati is not a separated thing? Because it's cause and effect driven. Only for as long as there are the causes can you have the effect of jati. So if jati itself is based in causes, how can you say that there are that this jati, or what you think is going on inside of you, is a separation? It cannot be, because it is not separate. Anatta. Yadanicchan tandukkam yandukkam tadanatta. Netammam netohamasmi nameso attati. So then don't be calling this yourself a self. Don't be calling these things yours, because it makes no sense. And don't be thinking that these things are separated. That they are mine or they are me. Eva metam yatha bhutam sammapanyaya dattabba. Once you have seen this, once you have realized this, then you begin to realize the true nature of all things. In this manner, eva metam, in this manner, you realize the true nature of all things. Sammapanyaya, through wisdom, through insight, you realize all things. That's why if the problem here is fixed, then the problem elsewhere is fixed as well. You can't have an arahant who only sees the cause and effect nature of oneself, but does not see the cause and effect nature of other things out there. You know, you can't have a half arahant. It doesn't work like that. And you can't have an arahant who sees all these things as being manifestations, but inside they still feel a self. You can't have like that. All of that happens at the same time. It's like when you go blind, all is blind. When you see it all. It's not half and half. That is why, if sometimes you might ask me a question, Venerable Sir, where do we apply the concept of anicca? Do we apply it to physical things out there, or do we apply it to this jati business inside here? My answer to that is, it matters not what you apply to, because it is not the thing that you need to apply to, it is the principle that you need to reflect on. It's the principle. Application has to be done with the principle of anicca, the principle of cause and effect. Yes, we use examples to talk about how they manifest themselves. So I'll talk to you about the red pen and the blue pen. Sorry, the black pen and the red pen. I'll talk to you about these as examples. But it is not to them you're supposed to apply it. You're just supposed to apply or contemplate on the principle of anicca, not these objects. But to explain this principle, of course we take objects as examples. A very common example I use when we talk about this phenomenon is, if you're trying to explain to someone the concept of weight, not weight, weight, like mass times gravity, force of gravity gives you weight. If you're trying to explain to someone the concept of weight, you're going to have to use some examples, haven't you? You're going to have to say, see, this object, it has weight. This object has weight. This object has weight. If at the end of this lesson, where I've used three objects, I've worked out their mass, I've times it by 9.8 meters per square second, per second squared, and I've told you this is the weight of this object, this is the weight of this object, this is the weight of this object. At the end of that, if you come and ask me, oh, I get it, Swami Nans, I get it. These three objects, they have weight. What about this one? If you are now asking me this question, have you understood the phenomenon of weight? No, you haven't. What you've been thinking was that I was trying to explain to you these three objects. That is not what I'm intending to do. I'm not trying to explain to you the nature of these three objects. I'm trying to explain to you the nature of nature. All things. That is why anicca is the phenomenon I'm trying to get across to you. Not about their application or how they relate to individual objects. The very reason that you see individual objects is because of that phenomenon. Yeah? So you can't come and ask me, I get it that these three objects they have weight. How about this object? Does this have weight? You can ask me what is its weight? But if you ask me, does this have weight? Have you understood the phenomenon of weight? You haven't understood the phenomenon of weight. So when you ask me that question, that is what I realize. You haven't understood the phenomenon of weight. So what do I do then? So I say, yes, it does have weight. It does. See, it has a mass. And it is in the field of gravity. So therefore, it has weight. See? And we work out the numbers and I tell you that is its weight. Then you say, now I got it. That's what people say. Now I got it. What did you get? I understood that these two pens have weight, the duster has weight, as well as the saucer that also has weight. What about the clock? Have they understood weight? No. See, do you see that what we're trying to explain to you is the phenomenon of anicca. Not whether this, that or the other is anicca. So the same applies internally as well. Because if all is anicca, is there a point in asking, is it outside or inside? Is there a point in asking whether it is to jati we must apply anicca or to the objects, the jati dhamma, that we must apply anicca? It makes no sense. Because we are trying to explain to you the phenomenon of anicca, not to the things that it applies to. That application we do because we need examples to talk about. That's why. But it's a phenomenon that one needs to understand. Because if you needed to work out whether this was anicca, first of all, you need to calculate the mass of this object. And if you can't work out the mass of this object, then you're lost. But if you understand that this has weight, do you need to understand what the mass is? If all you're trying to do is to understand the fact that this object has weight, it has weight, not what its weight is, the fact that it has weight, do you need to know what its mass is? Do you? To understand it has weight? No, you don't. But if you want to work out what its weight is, now you need to work out its mass. So then you've got to take it to the laboratory, break it down, chop it up, slice it up, and take all the molecules in there, work out their molecular weight, put it all together. You've got to do all that. But to understand the concept that this has weight, you don't need to know any of that. You know that there's a field of gravity. It looks like a solid object, so it must have weight. So what about jati then? Do you need to understand how jati happens? In fact, you need to understand all the steps that lead to jati. That it is first ignorance and then attachment and then vedana and then salayatana and then passa and then all that. You need to understand the step-by-step approach to jati. Do you need to? You don't need to. What must you understand? It's a process. That is the principle that you need to get. Otherwise, how on earth can someone just hear these words? Ye dhamma hetu pabhava. Te sanghetu tathagatva. Ye dhamma hetu pabhava was enough for someone to understand that this world is anicca. Who explained to him what those causes were? Who explained to him the causes? Ditte dittamatta. Who explained to him the optical process of seeing? No one explained to him that. Who talked to him about rupa, vedana, sanya, sankhara, vijnana? No one explained to him that. But here's what they understood. That there's a phenomenon of cause and effect. See, yedamma hetupabhava. Isn't the phenomenon very well pronounced in that phrase? In that phrase, yedamma hetupabhava. Isn't the phenomenon of cause and effect very well pronounced? It is. But are the causes themselves actually itemized in that? No, it's not. So then what did the Venerable Sariputta understand? He understood the principle of cause and effect. That is his becoming of a Sotapanna. So he realized if that is so, then all things in this universe must be cause and effect driven, including his perception of self. But what he didn't understand was avidya paccaya, sankara paccaya, vijnana paccaya, nama rupa. He doesn't understand that. Because he doesn't know. No one's taught him that. No one's taught him the step-by-step approach that leads to jati. But that is not what is required to become a Sotapanna. That is why Guru Hamdaro tells time and time again, study of Dhamma and study of Nibbana are different things. Reading the Tripitaka letter to letter, page to page, right from start to end, you will learn about the Dhamma. In fact, what you learn about is the chittas, the chaitasikas, the rupas, and how their concomitants are, how they work with each other, what their arrangements are, how they work together, which ones are mutually exclusive, which ones always appear together. These are just dhammas. It is not the same as understanding the principle of cause and effect. It's not the specifics we need. It's the phenomenon of cause and effect. Does that make sense to everyone? Wonderful. Yes. Exactly. We can ask these questions and try and understand how things are formed, and that gives us more knowledge about the world. It helps us to become more knowledgeable about the world. Right? In fact, now in some talks, you know, we take chemistry as an example. We take how words are constructed as an example. We take physics as an example. Our knowledge about these subjects that we've learnt in our past, thanks to our good teachers who've spent the time painstakingly to teach us them, we use that knowledge to give you examples. But that is the example. To give you examples of the manifestation of anicca. But then to think that the lesson is about the example, that's wrong. It's not about the example. Examples are only used to explain a bigger concept, isn't it? So if you ask the question, how is this anicca? We can use this as an example to explain how this is anicca. But at the end of that lesson, you need to walk away not having understood how this is anicca. What must you walk away with? What anicca is. These are only examples. I think that's clear to everyone now. Good. All right. So, we have a big day today then for everyone. We're going to start off with the Pirit chanting. That will happen in the afternoon, right after Guru Thero's sermon. This is protection. You know that the Pirit is considered to be protection, isn't it? The Pirit book is also referred to as the book of protection. Have you ever wondered how Pirit protects? Pirit protects through the principle of Dhammo have rakkati dhammachari. The Buddha teaches us how one can be protected. Dhammo have rakkati dhammachari. One who lives by the Dhamma is protected by the Dhamma. So then why is Pirit protective? Because what is in Pirit? It is the Dhamma. Right from his very first discourse, the Dhamma Chakka Pavattana Sutta, right? A number of suttas that have been compiled through the, having scoured the Tripitaka, a number of those suttas have been compiled so that it can be recited in the course of one evening, one sitting. That is conventionally today the book of protection or the Pirit book. What's important for you, for all of you, is as you recite those suttas. Now, because some of it is in, obviously most all of it is in the Pali, it may not all make sense to you. But here's what will. You've understood the principle of anicca. You've understood the Dhamma, you've understood the philosophy that has been taught to us. Bear that in mind and try to make sense of those suttas as best you can. In the Girimananda Sutta, for instance, the Buddha asks Ananda, Katamacha Ananda, Anicca Sanya. Ananda, what is this? What is anicca? And then the Buddha gives a reply to that. Because he wants the Venerable Ananda to go and meet with the Venerable Girimananda, who is indisposed, and to help him heal. One might wonder, how does listening to the Pirit help one heal from a physical ailment? All that is possible once you begin to understand that the body is a manifestation of the energy that the mind exerts on itself. That is all possible. None of this is now impossible. But in the same manner, what if this were the case? Let's say that, I'm not talking specifically about the Girimananda Sutra, what happened to the Venerable Girimananda, I'm talking about just generally, someone's ill, someone's got a bad back, a bad headache, or you know, some part of their body is ailed, and they're feeling very, very rough, okay? What does the Dhamma help them do? They help them to separate Nama and Rupa. In other words, what it tells them to do is to extinguish the sense of self, and thereby any physical ailments, any physical discomforts, they begin to simply perceive as a discomfort on the body, not on me. That only the Dhamma can do. Say if you have a bad back, for instance. If you suffer from this bad back, 75% of this ache will actually be a heartache. In fact, your mind ache. You're suffering mentally because of this. 75% of it is that. 25% of it is physical pain. But remember, you only know about this pain because of your chittas, right? If not the mind, how would you perceive it? That is why a dead body doesn't feel. A dead body doesn't perceive because, I mean, it's still cut. It's bleeding, but the body, but there's no mind there, so therefore perception doesn't happen. Yeah. So, but when perception happens, your chittas, your mind, perceive that physical sensation. It's a physical sensation. But when self or the sense of self happens, when jati happens in the mind, it identifies with that pain. That pain is my pain. And when that pain becomes my pain, you begin to suffer tremendously. Because you internalize that pain. You personify that pain. That pain becomes you and you become the pain. Sometimes it can be so painful then that you even faint. Because you have completely internalized that pain. You become part of that pain. I am pain. Not I am in pain. You become I am pain. So what does the Dhamma help you do? The Dhamma helps you to reflect on the truth of pain. And then realize that the chitta is merely identifying this sensation. So much so, ladies and gentlemen, just think about this, you know, think about this for homework if you want to. Right? Just an idea I want to leave you with. If you are ever cut somewhere, right, say some sharp object has just pierced your skin and it's bleeding, whatever. Do try and come to your senses in those moments at least. That this discomfort that you're feeling right now, the place that has endured that cut does not actually experience that pain. It is not felt there. It is not so painful in the sight of that sight of the damage. It's not so painful. This is simply the way that you perceive that pain. In fact, your chitta perceives that pain. It's not that bad where it has happened. It's a bit like, you know, the story where I think it was a rabbit, wasn't it, that cried that the sky was falling? Was it a rabbit? Rabbit? Rabbit, yeah? So the rabbit in the jungle cried the sky was falling and they started running. And then every animal that it met, right, they all started running with it. And then by the time, you know, they finally discovered, the whole jungle had escaped, had run out of the jungle, all the animals. So, but was it that bad where it actually happened? What had actually happened? Something just fallen out of a tree or something, right? But the way it was reported was very different to how it actually happened. And the same thing happens with physical pains. When you're exerting yourself, sometimes when you're at the gym, you're doing some exercise for yourself, right? Or you're working something, right? And you feel a headache or a backache or a leg ache or whatever, your stomach ache, right? When you feel these pains, do come to your senses if you can at least, that it's not so bad where it has happened. In fact, it's not bad at all. Yes, an event has happened. Maybe it's bleeding. It needs a stitch, right? Maybe there's a cut and it needs a bandage. But the pain that you are experiencing, that is not so. It is not actually there in the sight of the damage. It is simply your perception of it. It helps because now you go into action. You go into action to try and fix it. But that is all that pain serves. Pain tells you that something's happening with your body. Go and do something about it. That is what pain is for. Because if pain was so pleasurable, you wouldn't fix your bodies, would you? When things start to break? If this wasn't painful, if this was pleasurable, what would you do? You'd keep doing it until it broke. But biologically, it is designed so that you don't do things that break your body. That is why this sensation is painful, which is very different to this sensation. Because this doesn't harm the body. This does. The body is required for existence. All things in this world are geared towards existence. existence is what this world is for. Without existence, the world wouldn't be. So therefore, your nervous system, you know, what are systems for? What are systems for? Existence. So your nervous system, what is it for? Circulatory system, digestive system, excretory system, reproductive system. All of these are for existence. So therefore, here's a system, your nervous system tells you this is going to disrupt existence. Act, stop, 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 it is going to disrupt existence. Because you couldn't exist without this finger. If it broke, it would be very difficult to exist. That's why Guru Hanuman says, not even a single strand of your hair of hair on your head helps you to attain Nibbana. Because they are all products or byproducts of existence. Existence is the name of the game. This world has been put together for the purpose of existence. Now I'll ask you one final question before we conclude. Why do you think Buddhas come into this world? No. To stop existence. To ensure existence. Huh? Because if Buddhas didn't come into this world from time to time, there would be too much chaos. There would be too much disruption, too much badness, too much evilness, just too much of it, that the world would not be able to exist. Therefore, from time to time, Buddhas come into this world. And what has gone into chaos, they settle down, so that existence can always continue. Ha ha. They're all part of the same thing. That is not meant to make you lose your faith or respect or devotion towards the Buddha. It's simply to help you understand that all there is existence. If not for the Buddhas, you know, this world wouldn't survive. Because forever, I mean, how many Buddhas have come and gone? The world is still here, isn't it? Yes, the world goes through destruction, but it is formed again. And it destructs and is formed again. It destructs and formed again. There have been plenty of Buddhas in the past and there will be plenty of Buddhas in the future. If not for the Buddhas and not for the Maras, these two, they work together so that existence can continue. For existence to happen, there should be destruction. Energy has to be dispersed so that it can be brought back together again in a different form. That is what the Buddhas do. Their job is to disperse energy. Put it back where it belongs, so that that energy can be brought back together to form something new again. Don't ask me any questions about that. These are forbidden topics to be talking about. But that is all there is, existence. So all systems are there to ensure existence can happen forever and ever and ever. But the point I was trying to make was, whenever you feel this pain, you need to recognize that there's a system in place that helps you to perceive pain. It is not painful here, at the object where that damage has happened. It's not painful there. You simply perceive pain because there's a system in place to protect your existence. The body has to prevail for existence to be. That's why. So don't think it's so painful there. When you're hungry, it's not that bad. But it feels bad. When you're hot, it's not that bad because there's nothing called hot outside. There's just energy. This hotness that you feel, you know, when you're sweating and it's in so much heat, you know, you feel, oh my God, you know, I'm gonna melt now. It's so hot in here. Really, it's not so hot. It's not so bad. It's not so painful. This will help you one day when you're in a lot of physical discomfort. So do try and bear it in mind. At least when that happens one day, say you fall, you break your hip, God forbid, you crack your skull or something, or you break an arm, a leg, get a fracture, and you can't come to the monastery for 6 weeks, right? Even while you're at home, do try and reflect on this. It's not so bad where it has happened. This is like the rabbit that called the sky, cried that the sky was falling. It is the same concept here. It's not that bad. But your mind is simply perceiving it as bad. It's just a painful perception. It's not bad there where it happened. Right, so that's why we have Pirith. So what I want you all to do today, when you listen to the Pirith, do try and put the meaning of what you have understood. Do try and put meaning into those words, so they're not just words. And that's why it's not in Greek. It would be pointless otherwise. Do try and put meaning to these words. And then, every time you reflect on its meaning, it'll make sense to you. So like using a scrub to brush off that rusty metal, every time the Dhamma runs through your mind, it's doing what it needs to do. You don't need to think about it. In fact, you don't need to make the Dhamma work. You just need to contemplate on the Dhamma. The Dhamma will do what it's supposed to do. Yeah. So if something's dirty, you just need to put the water. The water will do what it's supposed to do. You don't need to go and do anything else. In the same way, if the Dhamma runs through your mind, the Dhamma will do what it's supposed to do. So make use of that. That is how it can be a book of protection, a chanting of protection. Just the words themselves may have an effect. May. But I'm not a big believer in such things. What I believe in, what action we take of ourselves. So what I believe is, if I can reflect on the meanings of those suttas, if I can contemplate on the Dhamma, what is anicca? What is the anicca sanya? If, you know, the Dhamma Chakkapavattan Sutta, when we start chanting it, you know, and the Buddha says that this jati has never been discovered before, this dukkha has never been discovered before. You know, it should send a shiver down your spine thinking, my God, you know, how fortunate we are, how blessed we are to be able to have received this. That'll inspire within you joy and you know, such positive emotions and feelings. Let that happen within you. Embrace that. So to whatever degree you can, reflect on the Dhamma. And that becomes your protection. All right, let's conclude for today then. Let us all take a moment then to transfer the merits that we have all acquired by making offerings to the infinite virtues of the Noble Triple Gem, listening to the Dhamma and engaging in various meritorious deeds today. First and foremost, let us remind ourselves how incredibly fortunate we are to be in receipt of the Lord Buddha's teaching, and with immense gratitude, let us transfer these merits to the bhikkhus and bhikkhunis, upasakas and upasikas, who since time immemorial have protected and preserved the sublime teachings of the Buddha and passed it down through the generations of the noble lineage in the form of the Sripitaka, which is thankfully available to us today to study, understand and comprehend the Dhamma. Let us also transfer the merits we have acquired to all members of the Mahasangha present throughout the world, including the chief priests of all of the chapters who have dedicated their lives to the noble path and have committed themselves towards the betterment of all sentient beings. Let us not forget that amongst them are the monks and nuns resident in your local temples and nunneries who have always been by your side through thick and thin, come rain or shine. Let us also take a moment to transfer these merits to my teacher, Guru Swamin Mahanse, as well as all the monks resident at the monastery and the Anagarika and Anagarika communities attached to the monastery. Let us take a moment to transfer these merits and express our gratitude to those who make great efforts to disseminate the teachings of the Buddha, be that by transliterating these sermons, sharing them out with others, or inviting others to join them. And may, through the power of these merits, if any of them have been born in the woeful plains, they redeem themselves to be born in the blissful plane. May, through the power of these merits, they abstain from the unmeritorious deeds, fulfill the meritorious deeds, fulfill the Noble Eightfold Path, and may they all attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us also take a moment to transfer the merits we have acquired to our devotees and friends of the monastery, who for the sake of merits continue to sustain the Mahasangha. This includes everyone from those of you who have contributed to the construction of the monastery, to those who provide the Mahasangha with shelter, arms, robes and medicines, as well as those who have passed on their know-how and continue to extend their well wishes. May, through the power of these merits, they abstain from the unmeritorious deeds, fulfill the meritorious deeds, fulfill the Noble Eightfold Path, and may they all attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us also take a moment to transfer these merits to our mothers and fathers, husbands and wives, brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, grandparents, uncles, aunts, cousins, nephews and nieces, our elders, friends and acquaintances, employers and employees, and to all those who have helped us, supported us and assisted us in any way, shape or form. And by the power of these merits, may they be healed of any physical and mental ailments and overcome any obstacles to their spiritual progress. May they abstain from the unmeritorious deeds, fulfill the meritorious deeds, fulfill the Noble Eightfold Path, and may they all attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us also take a moment to transfer these merits to the devas and brahmas, spirits and demons, and primarily the Sakadeva, as well as all the nameless gods and deities who have committed themselves to fulfilling and preserving the Sambuddha Sasana. There is also transfer these means to all the deities who keep a watchful eye over us and keep us out of harm's way. And may, through the power of these merits, they prosper in divine power and wisdom. May they abstain from the unmeritorious deeds, fulfill the meritorious deeds, fulfill the Noble Eightfold Path, and may they all attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Let us also take a moment to transfer these merits to our ancestors who have predeceased us, and to all those who have been our families, friends and acquaintances in this infinite long journey of samsara, those who have helped us, supported us and assisted us along the way. May they all rejoice in these merits. Let us also transfer these merits to the members of the armed forces, as well as the police force who sacrificed their lives to protect the peace and harmony of our nation. Let us also transfer these merits to those who have lost their lives in the wars, be they friend or foe, as well as those who have lost their lives in natural disasters and calamities such as the tsunamis and earthquakes, landslides, fires, blizzards, as well as the pandemics, reminding ourselves that they will all have been mothers and fathers to us, brothers and sisters to us, sons and daughters to us, friends and acquaintances to us. In this infinite long journey of samsara, it is in their bloodshed and sweat and tears today we are able to enjoy the comforts in life and practice the path in peace and harmony. May, therefore, being grateful to all of them, let us take a moment to transfer all the merits that we have all acquired to all of them. May they all rejoice in these merits. If any of them have been born in the woeful planes, they redeem themselves and be born in the blissful plane. May they abstain from the unmeritorious deeds, fulfill the meritorious deeds, fulfill the Noble Eightfold Path, and may they all attain the supreme bliss of Nibbana. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Finally, let us all resolve that may, through the power and blessings of all the merits we have acquired throughout the day, we be able to witness the advent of many hundreds of thousands of arahants on this blessed land. And finally, may you and I, and everyone who's helped make this program a success, become a rahatan mahanse or an arahataranin mahanse in this very life itself and in the era of the Gautama Supreme Buddha itself. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. May the blessings of the Noble Triple Gem be with you all. And the members of the Mahasangha will now transfer their merit blessings to you.
Raga ginnin midetnva Desha ginnin midetnva Moha ginnin midetnva Nibbana parana sukhayan Sukhita taravetnva Nibbana parama sukhayan Sukhita taravetnva Mamada siyalu loka siyalu satnvayo Nibbana parama sukhayan sukhita taravetnva Nibbana parama sukhayan sukhita taravetnva Nibbana parama sukhayan sukhita taravetnva Raga gini niveva Dvesha gini niveva Moha gini niveva Nivan sapalabeva Nivan sapalabeva Nivan sapalabeva
Tundvange suvisi ananta maha guna belen Silu loka silu sattvayam Nibbana paramasukhen sukta taravetva Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.